For today, we are reading from John's Gospel. We look into the 12th chapter. Verse 20, we begin seeing how some out-of-town guests in Jerusalem wish to meet up with Jesus. Now, among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor." Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." This morning I want to propose a hypothetical situation. Let us say you have just won an all-expenses-paid trip to London, England. You have confirmed it is not a scam. You really have won the trip. What would be on your bucket list to see while you were in London? Might you want to go to Buckingham Palace, where Queen Elizabeth lives? Might you want to go there when it is time for the changing of the guard? Might you want to go there when Queen Elizabeth would be driving right out of the gate on the way to Parliament or church at St. Paul's? Well, do we have a video clip for you? Now, let's just take a little moment. I need to move into the screen share and bring that forward for us. And here is the welcome to our clip. And then what I want you to watch for is after the motorcycles go zooming by, you will see a burgundy limousine. You will see Queen Elizabeth II in her Rolls Royce going downtown to a state function at St. Paul's Cathedral. So I've done the setup for this video. Again, here comes the band. And there's the limousine. And we line this up just a second there. And if I can get that to freeze, there we go. That is Queen Elizabeth. If you see her purple garment, that is her in the back seat of the limousine. So there's our brush with greatness for today. So again, just imagine how everybody was so pleased to have that happen. And, you know, what a bonus. Our tour guide was ecstatic. He said, "That never happens. That just never happens. You're going to go back to Nebraska and Michigan, and you're going to tell everyone to hire me. Please do not tell them that I can guarantee the Queen every time. That just never happens." We bring up the phenomenon of seeing dignitaries because it ties in so well with our scripture from John chapter 12. Our story starts out with Jesus and the disciples in Jerusalem for the Passover. Philip and Andrew are approached by some Greeks who say, "We would like to see this Jesus, this rabbi, prophet, that everyone is talking about. Could you arrange that for us?" Now, let us be clear, these are not Greek tourists. These are most likely Greek Jews. Over the centuries, citizens of Israel had to get out of town to avoid invading armies. These Greeks were likely from the Thessalonica or the Alexandria communities of expatriate Jews. They would be in Jerusalem for a once-in-a-lifetime pilgrimage to the temple to celebrate the Passover festival. They would have their spiritual bucket lists of what they wanted to see in Jerusalem. Their list would likely include see the temple, see the chief priests, make the sacrifices at the temple, and see any spiritual celebrities who might be there. Celebrating the Passover in Jerusalem was a once-in-a-lifetime event. But on this Passover, they have the once-in-a-solar-system opportunity to see Jesus. Not just any spiritual celebrity, they have a chance to see Jesus. They have a chance to see the Messiah. So far, we have talked about what it means to the Greeks to see Jesus. What does it mean for Jesus to see these Greeks? The expected response might be, "Bring them on over. I am happy to tell them about the good news of the kingdom." The actual response is, Jesus starts talking about farming. Jesus starts talking about wheat, and the Greeks want to come over and talk religion. We quote Jesus, "Unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." Why is Jesus talking about farming? Jesus is talking about farming because the other shoe has dropped. The Greeks coming over symbolized the whole world has now heard about Jesus. If the whole world has heard about Jesus, will it go to his head? Here is the dilemma. Jesus could say, "I have gone global. I have gone worldwide. Look at my ratings." This could go to his head. Or Jesus could say, "I am staying with God. I am staying God-wide or God-wise." The other shoe is dropped. Jesus needs to be ready. Jesus remembers, "I am not the entire wheat field. I am just one grain of wheat." The wheat field is the mission field. The mission field is the entire point of why I am here. The Greek's arrival means I am close to my final chapter. The chief priests are already worried that I am too popular. Now the Greeks know about me. This is just one more nail in my cross. I am just one grain of wheat. I need to remember my job, and that is give up my life so these disciples can carry on after me. My disciples are the fruit. They are the new wheat that is supposed to multiply. I must go so that things can grow. In the same way for us, we need to remember it is about the mission field. It is about the plentiful harvest and the laborers are few. Like Jesus, sometimes our ego must go so that the mission can grow. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground, it will not grow. Amen.